knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Moving right along from the nictogens, we reach group 16, which is the oxygen group, also known as the chalcogens. In addition to oxygen, this group includes sulfur, selenium, tellurium, polonium, and livermorium. Elements in this group have electron configurations ending in NS2 NP4, and it is here where metals are finally the minority. While metallic character increases going down the group, oxygen and sulfur are strict nonmetals. Selenium is characterized as a nonmetal, but along with tellurium, the metalloid below, these two elements have semiconducting allotropes. Polonium is also characterized as a metalloid, though it is distinctly metallic in some ways. It is highly radioactive and has no stable isotopes. Livermorium is yet another synthetic and exceptionally radioactive transactinide element, first created in 2000, whose most stable isotope has a half-life of just 53 milliseconds. With this group, we finally see a strong tendency to complete the outermost shell of electrons. Thus, -2 oxidation states will be very common, along with the +4 and +6 that we would expect from utilization of all p electrons or all valence electrons. So where can we find these elements? Oxygen is no problem, being that it is the most abundant element in Earth's crust, at about 50% by mass. It also makes up 89% of all the oceans by mass. Additionally, the atmosphere is 21% molecular oxygen. This can be isolated by fractional distillation of liquefied air, as it boils at a temperature just above that of molecular nitrogen. Sulfur has historically been found in natural deposits near volcanoes and geothermal vents, and is easy to mine. Sulfur is also found under geological salt domes, where sulfates are converted to solid sulfur by bacteria. This can be melted by steam and pumped to the surface through pipes, which is called the frash process, and it yields extremely pure sulfur. More commonly, we can get sulfur from hydrogen sulfide in natural gas. This can be reacted with oxygen to get sulfur dioxide and water, and sulfur dioxide can react further with hydrogen sulfide to produce elemental sulfur and water. Selenium is obtained from selenide impurities in sulfide ores of copper, silver, and iron, and is mainly recovered from the sludge of electrolytic copper purification. It can also be obtained as an impurity in sulfuric acid production from elemental sulfur. Tellurium, on the other hand, is one of the rarest elements in Earth's crust, more so than gold. This is obtained primarily from anode sludges of electrolytic copper purification, much like selenium, and also from dust produced during blast furnace refining of lead. The biggest producers of tellurium are the United States, Peru, Japan, and Canada. Polonium, as we mentioned, is highly radioactive, forming naturally from uranium in uranium ores, and can also be made artificially by bombarding bismuth-209 with neutrons. Livermorium, again, is strictly synthetic and too radioactive to serve any practical purpose. In terms of properties, oxygen has two major allotropes. Diatomic oxygen is a colorless, odorless, tasteless gas, and it is by far the more common. This has both a singlet and triplet state, which differ in whether the two highest energy electrons are paired in the same orbital with opposite spin, or alone in separate orbitals with spin aligned, the latter of which is more common and is the ground state. The other allotrope is ozone, or O3. This is found in trace amounts in the upper atmosphere and shields Earth's surface from ultraviolet radiation. Sulfur also has several allotropes, the most common of which is the crown-shaped S8. This can take on rhombic or monoclinic arrangements. Sulfur can also form highly viscous coils of indefinite length, which take on plastic-like properties. And when sulfur boils, it produces varying amounts of S8, S6, S4, and S2. Selenium also most commonly exists as Se8, which has a red color, formed from the reduction of H2SeO3, but it can also form long gray spiral chains. Tellurium will also tend to make long spiral chains. Now let's talk about applications. Oxygen has the most obvious application of any element on the periodic table, as without molecular oxygen to breathe, we die in minutes, just like all other aerobic life. But we have many industrial applications for oxygen as well. The chemical industry utilizes an enormous variety of oxygen-containing oxidizing agents. Many rockets use liquid oxygen as fuel. Oxygen can be injected into iron ores to remove impurities of carbon and sulfur. It is often necessary in the cutting and welding of metals. Oxygen is required for the production of ethylene glycol from ethene. Isotopic ratios of oxygen-16 and oxygen-18 are used by paleoclimatologists in their research. And of course, any process involving combustion requires oxygen to occur. For sulfur, it is the case that sulfuric acid is used in countless manufacturing processes, and it is synthesized on large scales according to this pathway, forming sulfur dioxide and then sulfur trioxide on the way. Sulfur is added to soil to lower its pH. Carbon disulfide is needed to make cellophane and rayon. Sulfites have utility in preserving fruit and wine. Surfactants and detergents contain sodium lauryl sulfate. And S8 has utility in fungicides and pesticides. Selenium is important for the production of Xerox copies, a process which makes use of the narrow band gap that allows SE8 to act as a conductor. Selenium is also used in light meters, though this is nearly obsolete, and it is found in glass and ceramics, where selenium provides a red color. Tellurium is found in some types of solar cells in the form of a cadmium-tellurium alloy. It is also present in certain memory chips and was a crucial component in rewritable DVD and Blu-ray discs, where tellurium suboxide reflectivity changes upon heating from a laser, allowing data to be written as dots of varying reflectivity. Polonium, as radioactive as it is, actually also has some applications. It is present in antistatic devices, where a tiny amount will produce alpha radiation that ionizes molecules in the air. These ions carry electricity and allow static to discharge. However, it is exceptionally toxic, with 10 nanograms being a lethal dose, so applications are limited, except for those with diabolical intentions. The murder of former Russian spy Alexander Litvinenko was carried out with polonium-210, most likely produced in Russia. And that wraps up an introduction to the chalcogens.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.